was Frank James and Jesse James, Billy Kid and all the rest. Supposed to be some bad cats way out in the west. But those cats could have dug me in my gangster ways. They would have hung up the gunshot and dug it to their graves. I'm all gangster. Gangster love. You know I'm a gangster. The gangster of love. Jump in my widow's Cadillac, rode across the borderline. Rolled 55 girls, I kissed them all the same time. To 25 or 30, put them all on a freight. It was $1 million reward for me in each and every state. Shouting your name, Stevie Guitar Miller, in a very deep voice. And I said, yes, sir, brother sheriff, that's your wife on the back of my horse. I'm a gangster.
Hello, this is Dan McClosky. Welcome to part one of an interview with singer, songwriter, guitarist, and hitmaker Steve Miller. Steve sold over 60 million records, and his greatest hits album of the 70s is in the top 100 best-selling records of all time. Here's a brief sampling of some of his biggest hits. This last song, The Joker, is Steve's top-selling hit. He's been inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame. And at 79 years old, he still performs with his band in large venues throughout the country. In this interview, he talks about his early years, his musical beginnings, and his godfather, Les Paul. For over 25 years, Les Paul had a weekly show in New York City, and here he is inviting Steve up to the stage at one of those shows.
Let's bring this guy up because he happens to be a dear, dear, dear friend. And it, what's Steve, what's your last name? Miller. Oh, I got you. How you doing, Steve?
Man, are you kidding? I'm having the best time of my life. You up here. What a show.
Now you know why I play a Les Paul.
Let's have a natural ball. You know, we're having a birthday party for little old Les Paul. Hey, Les, you can't take it with you. That's one thing for sure. So let me have that guitar, those pedals, and that amp. I said, you can't take it with you. That's one thing for sure. Nothing that a Les Paul guitar can't cure. Come on, Les. Mm-hmm. let's have a natural ball. Let your hair down, people, let's have a natural ball. Cause if you're not happy, it's no fun at all. He really is the greatest, isn't he?
Steve Miller. Steve.
And God bless you. You've been the greatest inspiration to me in my life, and I love you so much.
It's my pleasure.
This is my first interview in 50 years from my old days at KPFA. I'm lucky enough to be doing an interview today with Steve Miller.
That's, hi, Danny.
How you doing?
I'm well, and you?
Good. You and I got to know each other, I guess, in the mid-60s, around 66.
Yep.
I think you had come out from Wisconsin, was it, or Chicago?
I'd come out from Chicago and Texas, and actually I went from Chicago to Texas, tried to go to music school. They wouldn't let me enter music school, so I sold my books and built a bed in the back of my Volkswagen bus and drove to San Francisco.
Yeah. I remember I got a chance to record you at the Matrix on Fillmore Street.
Yep.
So that's how we got to know each other a little bit.
That's right.
I loved your band. I mean, it was just a straight-ahead shuffle blues band. I mean, it was just, it was just great. Of course, you went on to make a lot of big hits, so it was kind of fun to watch your progression. So I got some questions. I'm sure you may never have been asked this before, but I'll ask you. When did you start playing guitar?
Well, I got my first guitar when I was about 4 and a half, and my Uncle Dale was a very good guitarist, and he had been a professional musician. Then he went to medical school. He came to visit my family, and he brought his guitar. And as soon as I saw it, I was just mesmerized by it and tried to play it the whole time. And when he was leaving, he left real early in the morning. It was about 6 o'clock in the morning when he left. And I went running downstairs, and behind the couch, there was the guitar case, and I opened it up, and there was this little Gibson arch top guitar, little small guitar, and he had left it for me. I still have it. It's in the room around the corner. And I started banging on it, and then my father became friends with Les Paul, and Les Paul came over and showed me my first 3 chords.
Yeah. So this was in Wisconsin, right?
Yeah.
Because you were there till what, age 6?
Six. Six when we moved. So it was 1949. I guess we moved in 1950, I think. That's when I started school in Texas.
What was it like growing up in Wisconsin musically?
I lived in a household with my mother, my aunt, my grandmother, my cousin Carol, who was more like a sister, and my older brother, and my mom and dad. Very musical household. My mom and my aunt, they were unbelievable singers, and they knew all the jazz tunes and all the pop tunes. And my cousin Carol was a really good singer. And so I started off, the first musical memories I have were learning to sing Row, Row, Row Your Boat in harmony rounds. They taught me how to sing harmony. And then my parents were hipsters, and they had a lot of musician friends. And there was a lot of great music in the house. And my favorite record was Mead Lugs Lewis playing piano, Honky Tonk Train, Boogie Woogie Shuffle.
Yeah.
And I just asked my mom to play that over and over and over. And I just rock back and forth and say, play it again, Mama, play it again. Thank you. I mean, I was just fascinated by music from the get-go and learned to sing harmony in rounds. Artie had a very complex piece of music that I loved and I wanted to hear over and over. And then Les Paul came to town, and my dad became friends with Les Paul, and Les and Mary started coming over. And there were lots of parties at our house. And Mingus came to the house. And Red Norwood.
Charles Mingus.
Yeah, and Tal Farlow, and Les Paul and Mary Ford. And they would come over, and there'd be parties and drinking and smoking and carrying on.
And you're just this little kid.
Yeah, I was watching from the second floor, you know.
So set the scene. Your dad was a doctor, right?
Yeah, my dad was a pathologist.
Okay.
And we lived in Milwaukee proper. We lived in a little row house. There was 10 houses all connected together, and it was just a little narrow, skinny little house. And, you know, it was two blocks away from where Les Paul was playing at Jimmy Fazio's Supper Club. He and Mary were rehearsing there. And so just surrounded by music all the time.
Your dad, he had what is called a Magna Quarter.
We had a great record player and tons of records, great music.
Mostly jazz or?
Jazz and blues and gospel music. And my dad had a wire recorder and he loved recording with it. And of course it was just horrible.
Because a wire recorder is just literally a wire.
A spool of copper wire that was like a fishing reel, you know.
And it sounded like this, right?
Yeah, it was terrible. And all of a sudden, he somehow found out about Magna Quarters. It was a brand new technology from Germany after World War II. Yeah. The Germans were using tape.
Yeah.
And he had the first real professional tape recorder.
Oh, this was about 49?
48, I think. And so it was a really serious tape recorder, and that's how he became friends with Les Paul. Was Les showed up playing at this club. It turned out he and Mary were rehearsing for 6 weeks before they went to New York to do their radio show, which then became their TV show. And my dad went over and said, you know, I've got a Magna Quarter. Can I come over and record you? And Les said, hell yeah, come on.
He was a technical guy as well.
Well, yeah, he had the first Ampex recorder. Bing Crosby gave him one. He had the second one. He was
big old 10-inch reel-to-reel recorders.
Yeah, and this was a 7-inch reel-to-reel recorder. The Magna Quarter had three speeds, had all the stuff. It was a real deal. It was a very good tape recorder, and so my dad would go over, and I would go with him to the nightclub every night because it was just around the corner.
And they let you in?
Yeah.
Well, you weren't drinking.
No, I wasn't drinking or smoking. I was just sitting with my dad on his lap.
5 years old.
Watching him record Les Paul and watching Les play. And Tal Farlow would come in and jam, and Red Norvo would come in and jam. And I mean, it was crazy. And so I got to see all this phenomenal jazz being played at the highest levels in a really great little small club. Les Paul was the ringmaster, so everybody was laughing and having a great time. I thought it was the greatest thing in the world.
Man, yeah.
It was.
Yeah.
It was the greatest thing in the world. And I just loved it. And then Les and Mary came over to listen to the tapes, and then pretty soon they were over all the time. And then they decided to get married. My mom and dad were the maid of honor and the best man. They spent their honeymoon at our house. And as Les always kids me, when he was there, they were spending the night in my parents' bedroom, and I went into the bedroom on their honeymoon evening and said, are you really Les Paul? And, you know, said I wanted to use the bathroom. And, you know, he always kids me about that, you know. So so that's how it all started.
Wait a minute.
I just got to tell you one thing now. You know, I remember you when you were that high.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I
and you didn't even knock on the door when you came through my room to go to the bathroom, right?
That's right. Huh?
So we stopped what we were doing and let you go through.
You taught me everything I know, right?
Yeah.
Can you educate us about Les Paul, what kind of musician he was? He was a huge star, I understand, at one time.
Les was one of the best guitar players in the world.
phenomenally fast from what I heard.
And he'd just look at you. He didn't even look at the guitar neck, and he'd just look at you like anybody could do this. And he'd just be playing unbelievably difficult passages and things. That's the first thing I remember about him, was he was such an amazing guitarist. But at the same time, I knew that they were making records. And I knew that Mary was singing harmony with herself on these records.
She doing that?
Well, Les had worked out a way to hook up multiple tape recorders and run them all at the same time, and he was inventing multi-track tape recording. And at the same time, he was inventing the Les Paul electric guitar. Now, I didn't know that Les was a genius. I just knew he was this great guy who showed up in town, who was just doing this great show every night, and I was going to watch him. But I learned about making records. I learned about releasing records. Anytime they would release a record, Les and Mary would send us a pack of 100 postcards that they had written in supposedly different handwriting requesting their next single. And they would want us to mail them in Milwaukee, you know, to the one radio station in Milwaukee, you know, 100 postcards requesting that. So I learned about all of this from just knowing them, and I didn't really appreciate who Les was until later, but he went to New York and they had a little television show where they were on for 15 minutes. It's a very strange time in television. Television was just starting, and they were on, I think, 3, 4, 5 times a day. They just had this little thing where they'd filmed this deal and Les would play guitar. So I was watching this incredible career being developed right in front of me. I mean, they had, I think, 21 top 10 hits.
And he was making a lot of money at that time.
Oh, yeah. Les was like a big superstar.
So what years was this that he was really making those hits?
Well, I think it really started hitting like in 51, 52, 53, 54, you know, up into the 60s. They had like a 10-year run where they were just on the radio all the time with number one songs. Somewhere there's music.
High the Moon was a big one.
How High the Moon, Mockingbird Hill, Am I Blue, Caravan. You know, he was a great jazz guitarist. And anytime Les played, every jazz guitarist within 150 miles came to see him play. His audiences were unbelievable. The people in the audience were just there to see him do what he did. And then they had the television show, and then they just had all these hit records. They were Capitol records, and they became big stars. And they toured all over the world and did lots and lots of shows and were on the road. And I would, you know, my mom would get a letter from Mary, you know, talking about how they were in competition with Patti Page about some single or this or that or the other. And they'd send pictures and stuff. And every now and then I would see them. It was just the greatest thing for a little kid. I didn't even think about it. I just absorbed it all.
He had a very unique sound, too. Oh, you could tell instantly. And his sound was kind of a dry sound. It was like off of a mixing board. He didn't go into any echo.
Les Paul was the original guy who started making records in his house. He moved to Mahwah, New Jersey. He had this very modern, hip house, really a cool house. And he was making those records. He had the console at his house. He's like everybody that makes records at their homes now with their little consoles and stuff. Les had a big console. Multi-tracked. He and Mary did everything themselves. Mary was singing those songs in the shower and in the kitchen and in the living room. They used all the different rooms in the house for the different sounds. And when you listen to his records, like if we put one of Les's records on like right now, it sounded like it was recorded in a studio this morning. I mean, it's really fresh. So the presence on the records was amazing, and he had such a great sense of humor. You just were laughing when you heard him play lead guitar. He just threw licks and stuff. I'll just tell you one story about Tal Farlow. Tal Farlow was one of the great jazz guitarists of all time. I was in Milwaukee. I was like 5 years old. I saw Tal Farlow come into the nightclub. The nightclub in Milwaukee, Jimmy Fazio's, I was telling you about, and Les was in the middle of a solo, just going 150 miles an hour in a 40 mile an hour zone, just double timing everything and just smiling and laughing, and everybody was, and Tal Farlow walked in, and it was like a gunfighter had come into the club, and everybody went, ooh, there's Tal Farlow, this is going to be great. And without missing a beat, Les pulled a handkerchief out of his coat pocket and put it over his left hand without missing a note, and continued to play the solo so Tal couldn't steal his licks. From that moment on, I thought he was the greatest ever.
Oh, man. On the guitar, he sounded to me like Art Tatum. Listen to Art Tatum on piano.
Exactly.
You think you're hearing more than one musician.
That's a great analogy. He was so fluid and so fast and just so facile. I mean, it's astounding.
But what's tasty? It wasn't
just.
Everything. Just notes.
He got more out of the guitar. You know who kind of started to get tones out of the guitar? It was Stevie Ray Vaughan. Sometimes got so almost Les Paul kind of things out of the guitar. Les Paul is the master of all of it. And so you really understood the richness of the guitar, the electric guitar. The tone was incredible. Everything was unbelievable.
Wow.
Yeah.
Earlier you had mentioned his recording techniques. Can you talk a little bit more about what he did with multi-track?
First, he did layers between discs, cutting discs. They'd play a disc, and he'd play along with it while they were cutting it and cut another disc. That's how he got the idea. Then they used multiple tape recorders. He used variable speed oscillator to get everything at the same speed. and start them all at the same time. Then he started getting a master switch where he could run four tape recorders at the same time. And then Ampex started developing some sort of multi-tracking kind of device for television. And he went to Ampex and said, I want you to make me an 8-track tape recorder, and this is how it should work, and this is what it should be. And I think the first one was a 4-track, maybe it was a 3-track. Les was the guy in Hollywood. He was the hippest engineer in LA. And Bing Crosby used Les on all his sessions because he was such a great guitar player.
Kiss me once, then kiss me twice, then kiss me once again. It's been a long, long time. Haven't felt like this, my dear, since I can't remember when. It's been a long, long time. You'll never know how many dreams I dreamed about you, or just how empty they all seemed without you. So kiss me once, then kiss me twice, then kiss me once again. It's been a long, long time.
Les was backing up Bing Crosby on a bunch of his hits, and then he built a studio in his house, and everybody started coming to his house to make records. The studios hadn't really been designed and built yet, and he was the guy who started the whole ball rolling, and he figured out tape echo, and he figured out a lot of different devices. And one of his basic tricks that I learned as a little kid was he would record a part at 15 on the guitar and then drop it back down to 7, and it would sound like a bass. It'd be an octave lower. And he would slow it down to 3.5, and he would play a solo and put it back up to 7, and it'd be twice as fast. And so the guitar solo went dee-dee-dee-dee, was going, you know, and he did all that. But then he could play all that stuff.
He could play that fast anyway.
Yeah, and he multi-tracked like that in the beginning, and then they did Mary's Voice over and stacked her, you know. So,
really revolutionary stuff.
Right. The tools that we use now are all tools that Les really developed. I mean, the electric guitar, the P90 pickups, the PF pickups, the solid body electric guitar, all of those things. He was right at the forefront. He and Leo Fender with the solid body electric guitars. But Les was kind of a genius.
What were guitars like before that? Were just basically acoustics, semi-acoustics?
They were arch-top guitars with a pickup mounted on the guitar, and there would be a lot of feedback. The guitar would vibrate, and it would start circulating through the microphone into the amplifier, and it would feedback. And that's how he tried to get rid of feedback, to get volume. So for him, it was technically a problem, like he wanted to be heard. He knew every spot and every tone and every nuance of the guitar.
Who do you think in a more recent guitarist that came close to just total comfort with the guitar wherever? I would think maybe Hendrix.
Hendrix was like from another planet. He had a whole new way of playing. What he did was completely different. It was all feedback, and he was left-handed, and the controls were on the top, and when he would pick the guitar up, the vibrato bar was right there, and he'd squeeze it like this, you know, I mean. So Hendrix was revolutionary. People who really and truly, who really make the guitar sound good. John Mayer's really a great guitarist. Very facile, can play just about anything he wants to, you know, and do it very well. But Les had this energy and this sense of humor. And, you know, when he took off, you didn't know where it was going to go. I can't think of anybody, and I've thought about this many times, like, you know, when people think about really great guitarists, like Eddie Van Halen was a great guitar player, but he was no Les Paul. You know, Jeff Beck is a great guitar player and spent a lot of time trying to learn to play Les Paul stuff. And I saw him do a whole Les Paul show one time, but there hasn't really been anybody that good. And, you know, he's now remembered as, like, you know, Les Paul, the famous Les Paul guitar and all these things. But as a musician, he was like, you know, one in a century kind of talent. Really and truly, it was just unbelievable.
I think he was like 50 or something, and he retired.
He had a heart attack when he was in his early 60s, and he had open heart surgery. And then he retired for a little while. He got really bored, and he went over to a nightclub in the Village in New York called Fat Tuesdays, and he said to the guy, "What's your worst night?" And the guy said, "Monday night." He said, "I'll take it." He said, "Hire me, and I'll take it." And he sold out two shows every Monday night for 15 years in a row or something. And then that club closed, and he went to the Iridium in New York, and he did the same thing. You know, it was so much fun. I went to so many of those shows, and you would go there, and it was like sitting in his living room, and he was so generous. And he would tell stories, and he always brought somebody you never heard of. You know, he was always giving some kid a break. The other thing that was really cool about Les was Les would go see Jimi Hendrix play. Les knew Jimi Hendrix before Jimi Hendrix was famous, you know, and
well, he used to play with Little Richard.
Yeah, and Les really was interested in anybody playing guitar. He was not stuck up or snotty. And, you know, you could go over to the Iridium or Fat Tuesdays to see him play, and Tony Bennett would be in one corner, and Johnny Rotten would be in the other corner, and Jimmy Page would be over here, and some great jazz guitarists would be. There'd be all these people, and he'd call them all up. He'd have them all come up and play. And the audience loved him because he was just sitting as close as I am to you. You could sit that close to him and see him. And he was just funny as he could be. He loved entertaining people, and he loved doing that. That show, he played that show until he was 93 years old.
How were his chops at that point?
His chops are amazing. There's a YouTube video of me sitting in with him. We're playing I Want to Be Loved But by Only You. I don't know, he's like probably 88 or something like that. And you tell me how his chops are. As he got older, his hands became like claws. And he just
from the arthritis.
He just learned to play with what he had, and he never played anything bad, ever.
It was more jazz than blues, right? I mean, I never heard him as a note bender, really.
Well, you know, that's why you should listen to that song I told you about. You'll hear him play blues. He would play blues with me. He made fun of blues players a little bit. But he always had, you know, great players with him. You'd go in there, and Al Diamola or somebody would be in there playing, and then you say, "Come on up, Steve." And you kind of go, "Oh, I really don't want to come up." "But no, come on up." And play your three chords. You know, he wouldn't say that, but, you know, that's kind of the way it felt.
What was it like the first time he called you up on stage?
It's hilarious. I hadn't seen him for a long time, many years, like since I was like 12 or 13, and I was probably 28. And I decided to go over and see him. He was my godfather, you know. I had seen him. I went over to see him, and he was thrilled to see me. "Well, we got a special treat here tonight. My godson, Steve Miller's here. Steve, come on up here." And I was, "Oh, no, Les, no, thanks." I said, "Come on up here." So I go up, and he said, "Well, where's your guitar?" And I said, "Well, Les, I didn't bring my guitar." And he says, "What? You didn't bring your guitar? Are you a guitarist or not? What are you? You come to see me, you don't bring your guitar?" And I said, "Well, I didn't know you were going to ask me to play." And he says, "All right, we got a guitar for you." So he says, "Get him the guitar." Whenever you go to see Les, all his fans know that you would go to see him. There would be a Les Paul guitar on a music stand somewhere on the stage with a little spotlight on it. And it would be a very fancy Les Paul. The one that he had this particular evening was white with gold tuning keys, three gold pickups. It was the most deluxe, fanciest Les Paul ever made. So they bring it over to me, and I'm just looking at it like, "Gosh, this is really a fancy guitar." And put the strap on, and I didn't have a guitar pick. I had to borrow a pick. That really annoyed him, and he reached into his pocket, and he gave me a pick. So I picked up the guitar, and I plugged it in. It was a little bit out of tune, and I went to start tuning it, and the G-string tuner didn't do anything. It just went around and around and around and around and around. And I went, "Oh, man, you know, the tuner doesn't work. This guitar's out of tune." And so I went to turn the volume off. The volume control didn't work. So it's what they called the stooge guitar for people who showed up who didn't bring their instruments, you know, like, you know, big rock stars. So there I was. I was stuck with the Stooge guitar, a little, you know, just stunk just a little bit too much. And
he wouldn't help you.
No, and he just put me, take it, you know, there you go. You know, it was embarrassing. And, you know, I was sweating, man. I mean, I was just like, my body temperature was about 106, you know. I had little beads of sweat all over it, was red and felt terrible, you know. And I got home back to the hotel that night, and I hadn't given him back his pick. And I pulled this pick out of my pocket, and it was a custom-made pick. And it was made out of some kind of, you know, nothinium kind of plasticky kind of material. And it had some sandpaper glued on it at a little special angle. It was an odd shape, you know. And it had a number 2 on it, I think, or something, you know. And I went, oh, this is one of Les Paul's custom-made picks. So from that moment on, whenever I saw him, I always tried to steal some picks from him, you know, get picks. That was the first night. And I sat in with him many, 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 many times. And he always recorded everything and videotaped everything. So I've got videotapes of me playing. And this one thing, I Want to Be Loved But By Only You, I played some of the best guitar I've ever played. I don't think I ever played that way before or since.
That's great.
Yeah.
I wanna be loved but by only you. I wanna be loved but by only you. Because I never had a love as true. Your kiss is so sweet, honey, your love is light. Your kiss is so sweet, honey, your love is light. Thank you. love but by only you. Because I never had a love as true.
He actually taught you some licks, right? He encouraged you to play when you were young.
Right. He didn't really teach me licks, and he didn't teach me. He taught me my first three chords, which are so simple. If you'll hand me that guitar, I will play you the first three chords that Les Paul taught me. I was 4 years old, but you can do blues tunes with that. And then, of course, I listened to his records and stuff. Blues, Stay Away From Me, you know, he did lots of blues tunes. And I loved Mary Ford's singing, and I loved harmony singing. So from that time on, I loved the idea of doing layering vocals and doing stuff like that.
You said that your mom sang a lot around the house. Was it just solo singing, or was she singing along with records?
Oh, she'd sing along with records. She could play the piano behind her back, you know, cross her hands behind her back, sit facing you and play the piano. And she was just beautiful and cute. And her sister, Veda, was a comedian. And the two of them sang like birds. And my mom really and truly sang a lot like Ella Fitzgerald, which is really saying... That's a mouthful to say that.
I never cared much for moonlit skies. I never winked back at fireflies.
This is a brief sampling of Ella Fitzgerald.
Now that the stars are in your eyes, I'm beginning to see the light.
She just had that ear and that talent, so I got that talent. And all her brothers were musicians, professional musicians. I had an Uncle Paul, played in the Paul Whiteman Orchestra, played hot jazz violin. Was out in Hollywood, you know, did stuff like that. And my Uncle Dale played guitar. My Uncle CB played banjo. Before them, their ancestors, who were all Scottish, all played, you know, like I've got pictures of like three guys with mutton chops, kind of cross-eyed, sitting with their violins. I have their violins. You know, there was music in that family, and it was all kind of Scottish stuff. And I was just born with it. It really made sense to me. And we were always singing anywhere we went. When we'd go on car trips, we'd sing the whole way. When we were in the summer, we'd sing every day. And, you know, it was always just, there was music being played. And when my dad would come home from the hospital, he and my mom would have a drink and listen to jazz. He built himself a record player. It was mono at first, and then he had a very hip kind of stereo case that he built for his turntable and built his own Heath amp and, you know, a stereo amp and all that stuff. And he was just always buying records, and he loved jazz, and his taste was impeccable. So I grew up listening to Miles Davis and Coltrane and Chet Baker. That was just played in our house all the time.
Where do you think he got his love for jazz?
I think the radio. They were in Missouri. They were near Kansas City. There must have been some very hip music on the radio there, because I tried to figure out how my parents became the hipsters they became. And they really were. I mean, they were really different than most people's parents. They were like bohemian. They just had this taste and they loved it, you know. And then when we moved to Texas, my dad started taking his tape recorder and recording Sister Mahalia Jackson, and T-Bone Walker became a family friend. James Moody was over at the house a lot, and he was always just going around and recording people, and that was what he did for fun.
And he must have given a lot to them. You know, in other words, there was probably a very good dialogue.
Really friends. I mean, like, T-Bone Walker was like a family friend, and it was very difficult because it was Jim Crow, Texas, very segregated. Everything was segregated. And so people thought my parents were communists because we had black friends. My dad had lots of black women worked in his laboratories. Two of them went on to go to medical school and become pathologists. So it was a very open, you know, real relationship that my parents had. And, you know, it was considered unusual. He got arrested one time in Dallas. And his picture in the front page of the Dallas Morning News, handcuffed for having a race party in his laboratory at 3 o'clock in the afternoon before Christmas.
What was a race party?
Well, there were black women that worked in the laboratory, and they were having a little Christmas party. It was like 2 days before Christmas or something. And some racist at the hospital, like, called the cops, and they came in and arrested everybody. And they described him as like a swanky kind of person with a swanky house, and they smeared him. They made him sound like he was an abortion doctor or something. You know, it was really, really, really a rough lesson. And my dad...
Did it curtail him in any way, though?
Absolutely not. He went to the district attorney, who was a Democrat, and in Texas, Democrats were racists. You know, we didn't know that. We were Democrats, you know. And he had supported this guy, and he got the Dallas Morning News to print, you know, that quarter-inch retraction on page 48, you know, later. But no, he wouldn't. He didn't let that intimidate him in any way. I'm proud of him for that. I'm glad I grew up in his household.
Where are you going?
So you left Wisconsin. Any idea why your parents moved down to Texas?
Yeah, my dad was a pathologist. There weren't very many pathologists at that time. In the 40s, there were very few pathologists. I mean, maybe 50 in the country or something. It was the study of diseases, and pathology, you know, was the path lab, ran the lab. And he got a really great offer to go to Dallas and do pathology at a hospital in Dallas. So he went down there. And then he was doing pathology out of Texas in five states by mail order. People would send tissue samples to him. I'd unpack the samples and he'd do the pathology and we'd pack them back up and he'd send the reports back, you know. So that's why, you know, it was Texas, Southwest, warm weather, you know, that kind of stuff. So he went. Really, I don't know why he went, because I don't think they had the slightest clue about how conservative it was in Texas. And the politics that we are all suffering right now all were originated and created and implied in Texas first. You had H.L. Hunt, who was the first billionaire guy who, you know, hired a religious preacher to run a fake news program and, you know, promote his phony stuff. You had the John Birch Society. You had racism. You had all the stuff that we suffer from was just rampant in Texas. And I never understood why my parents went there. Why would you go there? You know, and I think it was just ignorance and financial opportunity.
You talked about your mom and her ability to sing like Ella. She was just a natural singer. She was always on key, right? The way Ella
was. Oh, yeah.
And that was passed on to you genetically, I would think.
Yeah, I think so.
Did you have to work much at that to stay on key?
No.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I don't have perfect pitch, but I hear harmonies and I hear everything at once. I hear whole pieces and, you know, I can hear a whole orchestra in my head, and I can hear the bass part and the guitar part and the keyboard part and the vocal harmonies, and I just hear all of that. And it's a genetic gift. I just started out wanting to do this. The first recording my dad made of me, which he played for Les Paul, and we have a recording of Les Paul talking to me when I'm 4 and a half. My father snuck in. I was doing a show from the second floor of our townhouse to the kids in the alley, making up songs, going, "Who wants to hear love song?" You know, I'd been watching Les play, and now I was doing my show with my little guitar that my uncle had given me. And he recorded me, and I was furious, you know, and then he played it for Les. Les paid me a quarter to listen to it, so it was my first paid gig. And I published that song and put it in my box set, and it's in my publishing company.
Oh, man.
Got the first one on tape.
Do you still have that quarter?
Yeah.
Wow.
Come on over, Steve. Hey, that was very good. You want to know something? You got a good voice there. I think you should keep singing like that. That's good. That's what I used to do when I was a little guy. Oh, you don't want to get embarrassed.
We all sing and play.
Steve, you're really going to go places.
You've been listening to part one of an interview with Steve Miller, singer, guitarist, songwriter, hitmaker. In part two, Steve talks about T-Bone Walker. He talks about his days in Texas and his musical influences there. And he goes on to discuss his college years in Wisconsin and his playing in Chicago blues clubs. We're closing part one with his huge hit from 1982, Abracadabra. This is Dan McClosky saying thanks for listening. Abracadabra. I wanna reach out and-